Gamer Guides, and I am continuing my Final Fantasy VII stream. This is the eighth part of the stream. I just finished Wutai last time I played, and it is time to finally close out Disc 1. I think it's about time to be done with this. So, yeah, I usually try to shoot for an hour and a half a day, but this time we will go however long it takes. Now, where did I put that stupid vehicle of mine? Okay, I parked it down here by the shore. Now, the next part of the game we have to go off to, since our little stuffed animal companion jerk helped Shinra make away with the Keystone, is... we have to head to the Temple of the Ancients. I know, such a generic name, right? Like, they only had the one temple. But before... Oh, come on. Really? You gotta give me another random encounter? Thanks for times 3 speed. Aeris, what is wrong with you? Your hit points are atrocious. Oh, well. I suppose we will have to manage. Why are your hit points so bad? I know you're a lower level. Oh, you're way lower level. Yeah, they'll probably do it. And why am I leveling up Chocobo Lure Materia? I don't really need to be leveling it at that rate, do I? Ah, well, whatever. It's all low-level stuff anyways, doesn't matter. First, though, let us go over here, and with the Mithril we got earlier... Yes, yes. Talk to him about the Keystone. The Temple of the Ancients! Oh my gosh! Didn't I just mention that? Yeah, it's just a legend, buddy. With the Mithril we got earlier, we can present it as a little bit of a gift, and we can choose between one of two boxes, the small box or the big box. Head upstairs, choose the small box, and you will get the Great Gospel, which is Aeris' ultimate limit break. And once you have that in hand, you can sit around and grind her limit level up so you can gain that sweet, sweet trophy, which I've already done, so there's no need for me to waste my time with it on this stream. So let's just head over to this Temple of the Ancients. I see you, Jared. What's up? Ah, of course I got attacked in the middle of this jungle. Actually, you know what? All they're going to do is turn us berserk anyway, so... Congratulations, you get the melee attacks I was going to hit you with anyways, and... you take slightly more damage. Since the game is so keen to play itself right now, I will let it do just that, and yay, victory. Oh, that's good experience. And Aeris gets a much-needed boost to her hit points with that. Fantastic. Oh, except she got inflicted with sadness. Well, that's no good, but who cares? Not like her limit break's all that useful at this point in the game anyways. Yeah, the dude told us this would be the Temple of the Ancients. Who are you talking to, you crazy, crazy woman? Probably the spirits in the temple. Yes, of course we're gonna go inside. And since one of Sephiroth's goons is here, reason only follows that he's not too far behind, huh? What are you doing napping on the job, Tsang? Tsang? How have you been tricked? I never understood that line. Ah, okay, there you go. It's not just... not necessarily a trick, Tsang. It's... you made a mistaken assumption. And technically it is the promised land Sephiroth is searching for, just not at this moment. So, long story short, Shinra didn't mess around for once and made it to the temple before we did, and had the misfortune to run into Sephiroth, who was also here. It's really strange because this whole black materia thing kind of just comes out of nowhere. I think they just off the cuff mention it at the inn in the Gold Saucer. And you hear nothing about it the whole entirety of the game up until this point. And that's just like, oh yeah, black materia. Sure, that's a thing. Just seems a little weird. Everything else got a proper introduction, and they've been hyping up this Setra Promised Land thing, but then all of a sudden the focus is the black materia. So yeah, whatever it is. That doesn't sound good, because we're all a little bit racist, aren't we? We all get scared by the black thing, don't we? Just like, we know Sephiroth is the villain because he wears black, you know, just black. It's bad, you know it's bad. Just call it the black something. Essentially, it's like the crystal of darkness. See? I love Final Fantasy VII, and I rag on other JRPGs these days because it's all the same old crap over and over again. Probably because I, you know, played all these games way back in the day, so it's kind of like, do I need to play this again? But it's always the crystals and the darkness with Final Fantasy, and you know, this game doesn't really break that mold. But it gets a pass because, you know, Final Fantasy VII did it before I was sick of it, so now when other games are like, the darkness, a crystal of doom, I'm like, oh, come on, I've seen this before. Yeah, but Final Fantasy VII, its narrative is actually okay compared to a lot of other games. So I think the black materia coming out of nowhere is just, it's kind of jarring considering that they actually bother to set up other story elements fairly well. So the black materia is kind of just, it just stands out more because they lay the groundwork for everything else. Let's finish chasing this other one. There's all kinds of treasure in this place, and not like I suspect anyone who is watching this right now has not played this game before, but if you haven't, there's all kinds of crap here, and you will not be able to come back and get it later. Yeah, like in Final Fantasy VIII, where they set up all these storylines, and it's you versus your childhood nemesis, and then they're very bad at foreshadowing in Final Fantasy VIII. And I know Claire loves herself some Final Fantasy VIII, but that, not everybody can make good choices all the time. And this is an instance where I think her good taste fails her. But they come out with so much weird crap out of right field. It's just like, wait, now we're all fucking orphans and, oh, hey, look, there's this super wizard in the alternate dimension that, or from the future, that we have to defeat. And it's like, no, that's not how you build up a good boss. And this place can seem a little scary to new players because you can't get out. And I hate every dungeon where there's no escape and you can't exit easily, which they warn you about there. But there's plenty of free healing in this place, so you shouldn't feel too claustrophobic about it. And this guy, he'll let you rest as much as you want. He'll sell you basic healing stuff. Not really anything too great, though. But don't be scared by this dungeon. You heading out, Rebecca? Okay. Now, I want to say that Final Fantasy X doesn't do as bad of a job. It the boss does come out of nowhere, but it's kind of like a daisy chain of events that leads you to finding out who the final boss is. Whereas in Final Fantasy VIII, it's just a lot more abrupt, in my opinion. I'm not saying it's good, but there were other elements about that game that were actually really good, like Seymour and Sin. And I did like the story twist. It's just then you get to the game and you're essentially fighting a summoning tick that affects summons, and it's like, ah, come on. I mean, it makes sense in the story, but it's the, especially gameplay-wise, it is the lamest Final Fantasy boss there is, because it's just, essentially, I'm going to do a bunch of weak attacks on you, and then I'm going to auto-heal. And if you don't use a summon, or if you don't have break hit point limit, then this, or not a summon, a limit break. If you don't use a limit break, or break damage limit, sorry, this battle's going to be tedious. But if you do, then you're just going to, you know, wipe the floor with this boss, so I don't like that the boss was essentially a chump throwaway. Can I actually go in here? Ah, okay. That's neat. Well, what the hell is the point of this place? I don't think there is one. Huh. Oh, right. No, right. I can climb that, those vines. Duh. I've forgotten more about this game than something, something, something. Ah, of course, you pack those two. Alright, why do I care about conserving magic? I have Magic Hammer! Wonderful skill I picked up last time. You're just gonna frog everybody. I'm such a bastard. Thank you for that. Now you're gonna get baited. Now, to be fair, Final Fantasy XII, it kind of built its boss up throughout, but it required so much grinding along the way and got so tedious that by the time you got to the final boss, you're just like, yeah, okay, whatever. I think Final Fantasy XIII's boss was fairly well laid out, and all the story was fairly well paced, but I just couldn't stand the gameplay. I didn't really like most of the characters. I liked Lightning because she punched people in the face all the time. And I liked Fang, because Fang was just cool. But otherwise, it was just a weak cast, and even though the story was well-paced, they took so much out of the game that was Final Fantasy that it kind of didn't feel Final Fantasy anymore. It was an on-rails Final Fantasy, and I know that's criticism everyone's leveled at it, but there's a reason for it, so now where the hell am I supposed to be going? Right, no, I was going the right way. I just gotta remember how to get back there. No, Saz was not cool. He was a stereotype with a bird in his afro. It's just, I'll admit he wasn't cringy like Vanille. He wasn't insufferable like Hope and Snow, but he was not a good character in my opinion. Well, compared to Hope and Snow, I'm cool. Yes, Hope was just the typical anime crybaby, and our Hope was. I said Hope instead of Snow. But, and Snow, I can't remember, but didn't he always say, like, really stupid lines like, I'm a hero, stuff like that. I don't know. Just whatever. Anyways, dodging these conveniently shaped rocks. Grab that morph materia up there by the pool, but if you didn't grab it and you just focused on the little rock puzzle. I'm surprised I didn't get hit by any of those rocks. I usually bone that up at some point, at least once. Not that it's difficult. I'm just incompetent. So... But if you don't get the morph materia on your way there, you get called back for a cutscene, and you'll be able to grab it right afterwards. But be sure to get that morph materia, because morph is just gravy at the end of the game. It'll be a long, 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 long time before you mess with it, but you'll want it eventually. Maybe. Then again, it's not really essential for grinding. It's only super useful if you want to min-max, but... So Aeris talks to this consciousness in the pool, and we get to see what transpired here before we arrived. And apparently the ancients were all Egyptians, because... Come on, tell me that's not hieroglyphics right there. Talk about cultural appropriation, right? Right? Huh? Yeah, you need morph to get underwater materia. You need morph to farm enemies and turn them into various source items. But that's min-maxing your stats, and... There are some stats that are worth min-maxing. Dexterity will make you so super fast that you're just vastly outpacing every enemy. Strength is always nice, so your damage is boosted even if your ultimate weapon is not optimally charged. So, but you don't need to boost strength that high, because most ultimate weapons give you nearly 100 attack. So you add your ultimate weapon to the base strength you get. You need about 150 strength, and then you're doing really good damage pretty much all the time, even if your ultimate weapon isn't charged, about 4,000 or so. And because of the nature of the enemies that are around, you'll get a crap ton of luck sources while you do this, while you're trying to farm your speed sources. And luck is nice, because if you max out your luck, you'll be pulling off critical hits basically every attack, so... Your base 4,000 damage ends up being very near to perfect damage, even if your weapon isn't charged, and if you play with the better characters, your weapon will always be charged. So even against most enemies with decent defense, you'll still be doing perfect damage. So, but that's way more grinding than... That's the most grinding I will even do. And I like grinding, but I'm not going to grind my vitality and spirit up to max or any of that crap. Or my magic score, really, because... It's not all that necessary. And another thing, if you get morph materia, you can quite easily farm yourself a bunch of ribbons. And I don't know any other way to get ribbons except for the two you find, unless you use morph materia. But anyways, big surprise, surprise, Sephiroth stabbed Sang. Fortunately, Elena wasn't there, because, come on, what kind of game would this be if a woman got stabbed by Sephiroth? That'd be awful. Horrific. And that's not gonna happen, right? And then just to show what a dick he is, Sephiroth shows up and sucks the soul right out of this spirit pool. Think about it. What a dick. That's right, Jared. I'm calling you out. Sephiroth is a far better villain than Clown Kefka loser could ever hope to be. There he is right there. One, he's got a better theme song. Two, his trademark isn't... And three... He's just a bastard. I don't care if he's a mama's boy. That just makes him all the more of a bastard. So yeah, you've been called out. Unless I'm misremembering and it was actually Greg who thinks Kefka is better. Or it might be both of you for all I know, but... Alright. This stupid clock puzzle. This will eat up some time. I could go look at my guide and just go to the ones that actually have stuff in them, but that's no fun. So, let's just try and keep track of this. 2 o'clock. What is in 2 o'clock? Nothing. What a waste of time. Ooh. I will proceed now, because there's a little encounter we can get into here in a bit. One thing you typically don't want to do is stand on the clock face while the second timer is ticking away, or else... Well, you'll fall into a pit of oblivion. And even though you can be damaged by a giant or a little frog smacking you, you can apparently fall hundreds of feet and not take any damage. Don't ask how the physics of that work, but it's video games. Don't ask. It just how it happens. But if you land in this little pit, you'll end up fighting some dragons, and I think there's a item. Woo! Holy crap! I don't remember doing that kind of damage. Oh, these things are nasty, aren't they? Oh, Eris. We don't need your healing wind garbage. Save it for the next... No reason you can't hurt things, right? Get some of your magic points back, why don't you? Yeah, that'll do it. Very nice. Wow, you guys just have it in for Eris, don't you? What a pathetic limit break. I know, that limit break was just awesome back in the day where it was essentially a free heal-all for your entire party, but come on, it's just been entirely outclassed by White Wind at this point. Eris, you're very quickly showing your limitations as a mid-game character now. And hey, one's gone, so at least they can stop flanking us. Might as well have Eris regain her magic points. This thing is a chock full of them. If you hear weird noises in the background, it's because I'm slurping on my oatmeal. It's my lunch. It's so exciting. Yeah, how'd you like that? Now, another thing I'm curious about. How exactly is Barret calling down sat strikes in the middle of combat? Like, if he's doing a sat strike, that means there's something in orbit, right? But Shinra never really got too far with their whole space exploration thing, did they? So, do they have satellites in orbit that we don't know about? Are they at least in the Sputnik era of space exploration, or... And more importantly, how does Barret have access to these orbital airstrike drones, you know? Don't look at it too closely, it's just video games. So, you'll get yourself a crappy weapon for Cloud if you do that. Am I going the right... I'm going the wrong way. I want to go up here. Ooh, game, you stop tricking me right now. And the theme for this dungeon, equipment-wise, is powerful melee weapons with no AP growth and no materia slots, which in my mind makes them absolutely useless. I don't think I've ever used any of those weapons. I have to be over a dozen playthroughs of this game too, so shows you how vital they are. Although, who knows, maybe someone's found a way to make great use of them and I just don't know about it. We'll speed through this one. You're not a dynamic foe. I think I'll take this opportunity to heal up a bit. And hopefully siphon some magic points off him. Yeah, wonderful. What a generous dungeon this is. Ah, hurry up and die. There you go. Now... Right, there we are. Let's go this way. That's wonderful. Now, back to the clock room. Started out at 10 o'clock. We explored... Nah, I didn't mean to do that. Let's try that again, but with me paying attention. I'll move it myself. If I go back in time, that won't get me anywhere, so I'll just go ahead. I'll just explore these. Huh? Clockwise. Let's see what's in number 11. I think number 12 is the way out. Another dead end. Lame. I'll move it myself, thank you very much. Wonderful. Pretty sure 12 o'clock is the way out of here, so this is probably a pointless place to go to as well. Yes, there's nothing creepy that's ever going to happen here. Just ignore the heartbeats and the shaky scream. Not very subtle, are you, Square? Square soft at this time. I'll move it myself. And we'll have to go around a full hour, because of course we do. Yay! Let's go to 1 o'clock. We've already explored 2, so this will make a third of the clock filled up. And this actually goes somewhere. Oh gosh, golly gee, what could it be? And it's a dummy chest filled with monsters. How do monsters fit in chests? Because they do. So Jared, do you think we'll see these enemies in the remake? Just humongous legged unitard wearing ladies? When you really think about it, Final Fantasy VII has 3 types of enemies. The great Final Fantasy staples we all want to see more of, like Cactars and Malboros and Tonberries. Then it has very, very super generic enemies like wolves, frogs, sexy unitard ladies. Nah, confusing cloud, not cool. Well, at least he hit himself. And the third type of enemy Final Fantasy VII has are the... What the fuck kind of enemy is that enemy? Just the weird amalgamations of various creatures and gross-looking things, you know? And I'm wondering how much of that makes it into the remake. I'm guessing pretty much all the series staples make it, but I don't have too much hope for much of anything else. Alright, let's go on with it. Why did I do that? We've already been to 2 o'clock. The hell's wrong with me? Of course I'm gonna move it myself. That'll do. Thank you. Holy crap, you're annoying. And just, is this supposed to be like another little spirit thing? Like, how would you like being that ancient? Hey, I'm the ancient that got stuck in a frickin' clock platform my whole life. Afterlife, I should say. That must have been the short straw pulled right there. And another random encounter. Ah, hooray. These things kind of suck, if I remember. I think they can absorb a crap ton of your hit points from you. So I'm going to just try and nuke them a little bit and see how this goes. Oh, wow. Maybe beta isn't the right way to go. Dick move! You're just gonna suck away all my magic points, are you? Ah, what a bastard. Wow, how many turns are you guys gonna get? And that's gonna hurt. Yeah. Bear, limit break. No? Seriously, how many moves do they get? I don't like these things. They're cheating. I think it's a, percentage attack, though, so... I'm not sure how much... I'm not sure if they can even actually kill you with those attacks. They sure can be a nuisance, can't they? Alrighty, let's continue on plundering this dungeon. Move it myself. Let's go forward in time. And speed this up. There we go. Oh man, I love 3x speed. Yeah, we'll go like this. Just so the next time I won't have to mess around as much. Yeah, so let me proceed. Next place! Hey, there's stuff here! Maybe it won't be another monster chest. Nope! It just so happens to be the Princess Guard, which is Eris's ultimate weapon. And if you heard me talk about ultimate weapons earlier, you'll realize this doesn't really fit the bill for what I was describing. has about half the attack that I said it would, and doesn't even have full materia sockets, so I think we all know why that is the case. And look at that. Yes, let me proceed before that second hand gets in the way. Thank you. And it exits us out here. And in this chest, probably the best bit of loot in this dungeon. A ribbon. And ribbons are fantastic. And I am shameless with my preference for Cloud right now. And I will put a ribbon on him. Protects against all abnormal status effects. And obviously, that means that it doesn't actually protect against all abnormal status effects. Now, I can see it not protecting against death, kind of. But near death and peerless, those are, and slow and stop, those are the definition of abnormal status effects. But even with its limitations, that's still a lot of things it protects you from. And being protected from petrification and confusion, silence, frog, small, berserk, paralysis, those are all very nice things to be immune to, so it's one of the best accessories in the game. You'll be getting another one not exactly soon, but not too terribly far off either. Now we're gonna skip 6 o'clock. And we'll just go ahead and move the hour clock over there. There we go. Because 6 o'clock leads us to the next area. And I want to explore this stupid clock before I move on to the next one. Trumpet Shell! Another of those no materia, no AP growth weapons. This time for Kate Sith, so it's a useless weapon for a useless character. And let's go to 8 o'clock. Wait for that second hand to get out of the way. And then, I saw that you've been posting, Jared. I will look down at the screen and see what you have said and respond to you in whatever way your post deems. Alright. Did that even make any sense? Whatever. I will respond appropriately to your post. That's what I was going for. Something along those lines. And that's a dead end, so we've milked this for all it's worth. It is time to... Why am I not going? I should go back in time. I'm gonna go back in time. No. I must resist the urge to sing on this podcast. Not podcast. Stream. It just bother everybody if I do. So, I couldn't be bothered to look at my own guide for that last section, but you know what? I'm gonna go pull that thing up now. Because we got ourselves a little bit of a puzzle. Mr. Stupid Butt Wipe Ancient Guy ran off with the key. And like the game explains, he's going to run through doors, and it's essentially the old Scooby-Doo puzzle, right? So, Legacy of the Ancients. Let's go to the Temple of the Ancients section. Yes, sir. And let's look at this fabulous map somebody has made. Wow, what a pretty guide. I would totally buy this guide if I was someone. So, he's going to enter in door number 1 and come out door number 4. And this would make sense to you if you were looking at the map I was. Hope I'm reading this correctly. And... yeah, okay, that'll do it. So, let us drop down to the lower level here. Oops, wrong button. And dispense with this little bit of tomfoolery. Catch this ancient right off the bat. Fantastic. And just keep going through the same door until I get back up to the top. Lovely. Alright, I didn't want to do that because I think he will let you rest and save. Yay! Get all my stuff back, and since I'm a compulsive saver, here we go. Now, hint, there is a boss battle coming up, and it would do well for us if we prepared ourselves to deal with it. So, Let's do that. Should have had this done going into it, but... it won't hurt for you all to sit through me setting up. And I don't even know why I'm leveling some of this materia up right now, but... be that as it may, level it up I shall. Now, the boss... one of the more cliche RPG foes you will ever face. Let's just say it uses fire, and you can probably figure it out from there. Make sure I have my enemy skill on, and... you know, why not? Can't hurt to have more luck. Eris, you should already have a fire ring on. So, I just need to make sure Barrett is ready to go. Nope, I have to stick to the correct order. Yeah, we don't need fire all anymore. Let's go fire, elemental, we will stick, restore all on you. And hit point plus doesn't need to be joined with anything. It's got another all, that would be senseless not to level it up. So what else do you got up here? Lightning? Well, I'm leveling up every other element. I might as well stick ice on there. How about that? Fantastic. Sounds fantastic. So, while I've got my guide up, I might as well check. Is there anything this boss is weak to? No. Okay, fine, I guess. So, we're fully healed, except for the rearranging of our... oops, I don't want to save again. Not yet, anyways. Might as well rest first. Except for the rearranging of our materia, which lowered our hit points, so let's go save one more time. Now we got everything in order. I should be resistant to fire, although the critter's main damage will probably be physical anyway, so what's it matter? Go back to the surface! Ah, there we go. And let's go to the end of this dungeon. And yeah, I know it's not really a dungeon, but RPG parlance. Everything with enemies, loot, and the roof is pretty much a dungeon. Sephiroth's gonna be creepy again. Let me read what you've been saying at me, Jared. I think near death is, yeah, probably when your hit points are critical and you're down on one knee. It should really protect against death, though. I mean, death is not the same as KO, to as far as I understand it, because everything can be reduced to zero hit points, more or less, but applying a death effect is still something that should be... but I guess then they wouldn't be able to put in the safety bit accessory, which protects explicitly against that, so... oh, where can you find this guide? You can find this guide at www.gamerguides.com. And on iTunes and Google Play. And I was just on Google Play yesterday. I think it has a rating of 4.8 stars on that site, so... the community has spoken. It is apparently a very fine guide. Well, thank you for that shilling opportunity, Jared. And Sephiroth, doing what villains always do, is monologuing and... going to tell you his crazy plot while he mysteriously flashes multiple colors, because that's another thing villains tend to do. Simply put, he wants the black materia, which is meteor materia, that will summon another large celestial body, collide it with the planet, and... well... apparently, when the planet gets injured, right, the planet's scabs are essentially soul energy. That's how it heals itself. So, humans use platelets, the planet uses our souls. And just as scabs are delicious and nutritious, so are living souls. And Sephiroth wants to ram the planet with another planet, cause a huge injury, and sit at the middle of that delicious, delicious injury while the planet heals itself and suck up its yummy planet energy and become a god. So, kind of messed up. Cloud also played his little I'm going to spaz out and glow and be weird, and like always, everybody helpfully ignores it, pretends it doesn't happen, so the issue will never get resolved before something bad happens. Lovely, 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 lovely. How's that for a nice little rundown of what happened? Oh, did you just limit break Cloud? That is very good for me, not so good for you. Yeah, but Sephiroth is such a cool villain. And the music's so great that when he says generic bad guy, I'm gonna do bad things stuff. I mean, it's kind of also the plot of Baldur's Gate 2, so maybe I just like that plot. John Irenicus, I'm gonna mess with the god tree, the elven tree, and suck its energy out and become an elven deity, and yeah. No, it's just a great plot. If the villain is evil enough, the music is good enough, and the gameplay is fun enough, you can have a generic plot. Wow, that boss sucked ass. What a wuss. He didn't even put up a fight. I wasn't even paying attention, really. Big guard and smack him around. And for killing that wussy dragon, he'll give us a lovely dragon armlet. And note that bouncing ball of joy right there. Yeah, see it right there on the bottom of the screen? Yeah, be sure to get that if you ever want to get Master Summon Materia. Now, I don't mess around with Materia too terribly much. But for Bahamut... I mean, come on. It's Bahamut. How can I not? I'll just get rid of fire. It's outdated anyways. I just want to stick you on here. So, keep leveling up. Actually, you know what? Why don't I just fast track my all? I could use the gill, couldn't I? And let's just keep leveling up that. I'll equip Bahamut on Eris. Not that I need it to win the next fight, but she's kind of offensively limited. So, all right. Let's not get ahead of ourselves here, right? And while I'm thinking about it, let's go equip that lovely dragon armlet on Cloud. Oh, what am I doing? I could just have Cloud equip Bahamut. I'm not going to, though, because he's got better things to do in the upcoming fight. Like, hit things. You already have fire materia. Why would I equip that? That's redundant. Do you have lightning, though? No, you do not. So you can have some lightning, too. Alright, let's go deal with this. You're gonna have to hear me rant again, Jared. Brace yourself. Black materia! What could that say? Yes, thank you, Cloud and Eris. You two are frickin' geniuses. Shake it, take it, leave it alone. I'll shake it. So, yeah. Didn't Sephiroth suck all the souls out of this place? How are you still talking to them? So, let's just zip through this little bit of dialogue that everyone has talked about. Apparently, the temple itself is a black materia, which is not cool, because how the hell will we ever fit it into our weapons and armor if it's the size of a frickin' building? And they play it up like it's some sort of puzzle, but really, you just gotta double down and reach in really hard, and you'll kind of do an inverse reduction of the temple where you grab the black materia and shrink the temple while you're inside of it, which obviously isn't good for you if you are in any way, shape, or form alive. You know, while I'm here, I might as well go save and rest and all that stuff. Now, Sephiroth has a horde of disposable goons that he will gleefully sacrifice to get the black materia in his hands. Fortunately, we have Kate Sith, so... And oh no, who knew that a shaky room with heartbeats playing in it could possibly harbor some sort of badness? But it does! And we're fighting a wall. Isn't this a boss in Final Fantasy XII? Now this boss is actually kind of tough. He's one of the more difficult bosses in the game, so I'm going to soften him up by using that lovely Bahamut materia I found. This will be the first and probably only time that I cast this in the entire game, so enjoy the animation. Yeah, this is a, given the location in the game where this boss is actually one of the more difficult ones. So, he does a crap ton of damage and it's fairly sturdy. I'm not sure how I would beat this thing if I was doing a speedrun, which I'm not, but... Yeah, aren't you also in some weird ancient temple and you have to fight a wall boss on a bridge and it's, like, timed or something? I distinctly remember that part of Final Fantasy XII. That'll be fun doing that again. And this boss is kind of annoying. A lot of Final Fantasy VII bosses do this, but he'll, like, weirdly gesticulate, and it'll take up time, and you're like, what are you doing, attack or not? I'm just being whiny, I guess. But I always found bosses in these games that do that to be kind of annoying. It's just like, why are you wasting my time? Why do you have to take a combat action to, like, rotate your arm? It's a silly, silly game. So Aeris is contributing however she can by using that question mark enemy skill. It's cheap and gonna allow her to do more damage than she otherwise could do, right? Ah, right. And I got so caught up in, talking in the previous room that I forgot to tell you all that while you're in the previous room with Bahamut, that would be a good time to take any weapons off of Aeris you might want to keep. Just a little bit of FYI for you. Not that, you know, there's any reason I'm saying that. Now, he must be hurt. He's double attacking now. So, you've watched a lot more speedruns than I have, Jared. What makes this boss so difficult in speedruns, per se? Is it just because he's a relative heavy hitter at the time, or... Because I don't know the first thing about speedruns. Now, Kate Sith is going to show up and give Cloud and Aeris another fortune. How compatible we are! Oh, shut up, Kate Sith. Tifa's not even here. Nobody believes in you, Kate Sith. You have a disposable body. We are literally killing you off to get our hands on world-destroying materia. So this is the rant that was coming up. This is the part I fucking just... I can't stand. Because just earlier in the Gold Saucer, when Kate Sith was stealing our keystone, he was like, well, what are you gonna do to me? This is just a stuffed body. But now that we're sacrificing him, we're using him as disposable garbage to get this materia, he's like, right here, there's only one me, blah, 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 blah. No, this is not you. This doesn't even make sense given the character who controls you. It's just, like I said in my guide, it's like somebody was too attached to their Daikimakura, and I don't know if that's the correct pronunciation, but essentially Japanese sex pillows, right? And they were just like, well, I had a really special pillow back in the day, and this is kind of close to the same thing, right? No! You're a stuffed animal, and you even said so yourself an hour ago. You're not special, you're not useful, you're not unique, especially because there's going to be another one to you that shows up in 5 seconds. I don't know why. That part's just a pee for me. It annoys me. I don't know why. I shouldn't get worked up about stupid things like that. Another thing, Kate Sith reads Cloud's and Aeris' fortune, and if you've played the game, I guess, canonically, you'll be like, oh, yay, a little talking toy that's a spy says, hey, you two have good chemistry. Even at this point in the game, Cloud is getting along better with Barret than he is with Aeris, so still not much Kate Sith knows, right? Anyways, we get the Black Materia, and all of Cloud's repressed random freakouts throughout the game are finally going to come to bite us in the ass in a bad way. Now you are in control of little kid Cloud, who's trying to tell him to quit being a dumbass. Don't give the Materia to Sephiroth, but... yeah, you know, instead of everybody enabling Cloud and ignoring his random spaz-outs throughout the history of the game, maybe they should have looked into this a little more to figure out, because this kind of mental instability in somebody who you're entrusting to get their hands on the world-destroying ultimate Black Materia, it's not smart. Very not smart. You are a bunch of incompetent heroes. And Cloud goes bonkers on Aeris, smacks her around, and yeah, I wonder if that will be in the remake. Huh? And after Barret knocks him out, like any good Barret should in that predicament, Cloud has a little bit of a dream, and, a little bit of plot exposition here, where Dream Aeris will tell him where she's going, what she intends to do, and apparently Cloud's mind is just an absolute open book, because even Sephiroth will show up, but that's not surprising. Sephiroth's been in Cloud's mind the whole game now, right? So, Cloud will spill the beans, and based on Cloud's hunch, because Aeris and Sephiroth talk to me in my head, he'll tell them where he thinks they are going, and yeah, it's not a good thing if Sephiroth is after Aeris, right? No. So, Cloud tries to cower out, but once again, Tifa enables him, and everyone kind of just believes him on a random hunch, even though he's a crazy. I don't know. Kind of weird. Kind of weird, I have to say. At least Barret's pragmatic about it. Cloud starts malfunctioning. He'll give him a smack and everything will work out, right? Right? No, that's not right! Cloud is triggered. He needs a safe space, clearly. Just so many things wrong with this, but I'm going to infuriate Jared, perhaps, and give Final Fantasy VII the benefit of the doubt and just say, yeah, these are dumb. They're... I should consider them outright plot holes, but I'll just go and say, nah, Tifa and Barret and the whole Final Fantasy VII crew, they're just really, really, really incompetent. I know, it strains credulity to think, who could be incompetent enough that when somebody spazzes out, assaults a party member, and gives world-destroying magic to a supervillain, maybe they should just be retired from the fight. Maybe they're going to do more harm than good. But apparently that thought does not come into the minds of our intrepid heroes, and they continue to enable Cloud's psychosis, much to the potential detriment of the entire world. And a good thing I bought a diamond knuckle for Tifa, because now she, or well, somebody else, I suppose, anybody else can take over for Aeris in this scenario, but I'm going to keep Tifa around because I like her reaction to the event coming up more than anybody else, so... Although, after this part, I'm not sure if I will go with Vincent instead of Tifa. I haven't really decided yet. And wow, you just have a whole crap ton of space, don't you? I guess I'll just level up anything my heart desires. Oh wow, your hit points suck. Oh well. She's an understudy. He doesn't have Omni Slash yet, Jared, so... I mean, he does have really good stats, but if he turns crazy and starts attacking you, you might not want him to have those really good stats. So, as Eris told us, she's going through the Sleeping Forest, but unless you get an item called the Lunar Heart, the Sleeping Forest will stay sleeping, and while it's asleep, it pretty much has endless screens simulating you not being able to find your way through it. So, we have to go digging for this Lunar Harp. I don't know how Eris managed it. Did she excavate the Lunar Harp and bury it back again after she was done with it? Can she just find her way through because she's a Cetra? Are there multiple Lunar Harps? Who knows? Point is, we're lucky all these people just happen to be digging here. Because otherwise, I guess we'd have to do it ourselves? I don't know. I don't want to set staff. Oh. And if I'm correct, I've done this a few times, so hopefully this pans out. Let me check out that wonderful, wonderful guide I have totally not been shilling. Because I believe somebody was generous enough to... Oh yeah, no, that should be pretty much the exact location. You don't need to pay anybody. Just come to this spot right here on the top shelf, right to the right of the smoke plume, and set people to dig right here. And with any luck, that should be where your Lunar Harp is located. Just make sure you select to dig for a Lunar Harp and dig in that location. And let's see if that paid dividends. What? Alright, well, at least I didn't waste any money on it. Let's try this again, guys. Damn game making a fool of me. Let's try right here. Blow up a bomb, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, I know how this works. Get to digging. Give me my Lunar Harp, game. There we go. I guess I was off by a magic pixel. So, yeah. Dig right up by that plume. You don't have to waste any gold on these charlatans. These frauds. And now the Lunar Forest should be awake so we can get through it. But while we're running through this... There is a nice little bit of treasure we can get. Yeah, I totally did that on purpose. There was some commercial back in the day that said pleasure instead of pleasure, so... That's what I'm referring to. I know, obscure as hell. I'm going to the forest, and there should be a little flashing... There it is, flashing motes of light. Ha! Couldn't run away from me. Look for the flashing motes of light, chase it around, and run towards it and hit X like a madman. And with any luck, you should grab hold of the Kujata materia. I know, I love how I'm saying all these things like it's still a secret. Still, I wrote a guide for it, and it would be kind of stupid for me to play through and not show everybody where everything was, right? Also, there are enemies in this place, If you should so happen to get your hands on another bit of enemy skill materia, you know, just on the off chance that that happens. There are enemies in this area. They look like little spiky hedgehog things. Maybe I'll run into them, maybe I won't. They also have the death sentence enemy skill. And if I remember correctly, this is the only other place in the game where you can get it, so... God, those things wasted a lot of time. I'm gonna buffet you with leaves! Ah, there they are, spiky hedgehog things! Yes, they have the death sentence enemy skill, so... If you want another copy of that, just be sure to come back here at some point and pick it up. And right, before I forget... equip. I'm gonna go to equip. We just got ourselves a water ring. Where are you at? There it is. And the number of enemies who use water attacks are... few and far between, but it just so happens we're about to face one, so... it's not entirely the worst thing ever to put that ring on somebody right now. And man, do I love beta. Does it simplify battles? I'm still nursing this bowl of oatmeal. Alright, here we go. Shit gets real at this point. Everyone get some tissues, prepare yourselves. Now, I've said this about a million times, and I'll probably say it a few more, but I absolutely love the music in this area. Fantastic. I run a bunch of D&D campaigns, and I love video games so music so much that I kind of don't really have any, I don't have a bother to listen to real music. There's some things I listen to, but most of the stuff I listen to is video game music, because I kind of like to play out little cutscenes in my head. I have my entire game world and all these characters that I've created, and Rebecca and I are kind of doing our own thing, making our own little fantasy world. So I'm much more interested in music that doesn't have, like, lyrics and a bunch of little angsty 20-year-olds crying about love and girlfriends and other trivial affairs like that. I like music that I can just listen to and imagine. Use my imagination. And I use this theme for some ancient elven city. It's just... I use a lot of music from video games to set up scenes and locations and characters, so... probably part of the reason why I like video game score so much is just because... I can listen to it and imagine my own stuff... and it just, it has its own meaning for me. One, it means something in the game, but I've also co-opted it into my own thing, so... eh, just sharing a little bit with everyone, I guess. God, that was uncalled for. What the hell am I doing? Personalizing with you all. Going back to when I was 13 years old in my head here, and this part of the game always... it has significance for me. It's not the first RPG I played that really, really impacted me, really hit me in the feels, but probably the second or the third. I remember Phantasy Star 4 was a big one, but a lot of the memories coming back, a lot of nostalgia here. Anyways, loot the Forgotten Capital and Barrett. When he sees a bunch of beds. How long could these beds have been here? Like, the raw material that makes up a bed would rot, wouldn't it? Of course it would. But Barret sees it, these beds are surprisingly intact, and, well, we decided to catch some Z's, right? Because that's what I would do in a creepy, forgotten city where Eris and Sephiroth are playing. And Cloud feels it in his soul, which... I'm not going to demean that too much, but I guess he didn't say... I swear it on my sanity. I wouldn't trust that. So I'll give him credit for I feel it in my soul, because I trust his soul a little bit more than I trust his sanity at this point. Alright, search the end of the topmost bed. You can barely see the little yellow outline. I'm sure everyone knows this by now, but... Bam! Enemy skill materia number 3. And I've been depriving Barret too long. He's the holder of my second enemy skill. Eris, you're not going to usurp that from... Or not Eris, Tifa. You're not going to usurp that from him any longer. You back off, woman. So let's give him back his enemy skill, put the new one on Tifa. Hey, how about that? Just like someone knew there's going to be another enemy skill here. Yeah, considering how nutso Cloud is going at this point in the game, him having Omni Slash, not a good idea. Now here's a question for you. This might be a little too metagame, but Cloud has a ribbon on, which means he's immune to abnormal statuses, right? So does insanity count as an abnormal status? Clearly doesn't protect against that because, Sephiroth can still totally mess with his mind. So he can't be confused in the general state, as in by enemies, but... he still can be confused by other things. So, yeah. It's kind of like that old chestnut that we'll come up with in a bit, but if a character dies, why didn't they just give her a phoenix down? And there's a built-in excuse. Well, they don't really die in the game. You know, when they lose in combat, like... when a 100-ton giant green underwater monster stomps on you, you're not dying, you're just being KO'd, you're being knocked out. Which, yeah, is the most stupid excuse ever, right? But that's how they rationalize it. Everything, even if it's called death spell, everything that happens to you in a battle isn't really killing you, it's just giving you a bad case of the KOs. Not Kevin Owens, the wrestler. But knockout. So go up to the top of this little building, grab yourself the comet materia, which is fairly useless. I don't use it. It's got fairly poor damage per mana cost ratio, so... look at this beautiful architecture. How did it manage to remain intact? Those stairs, they must be made out of... that just doesn't look architecturally sound. They must be the sturdiest flight of stairs there has ever been. Shit, here we go. Almost feels like I shouldn't narrate through this, but that's kind of the whole point. So, based on a gut feeling Cloud has... your soul's in your gut, why not? They track down Eris to the previously hidden bowels of the ancient capital. Barret wanting to bluster on. Cloud weighs him down, and let us go see what Eris is up to, shall we? And remember what we were saying about Cloud maybe not wanting him to have Omni Slash? Yeah. Hey, where'd that sword come from? Cloud just did just bend over and it appeared in his hand. Let's not think about it too much. Fight against it all you want. Can you just rock back? How was I... okay. I don't remember doing that before. Yes, let's do some untimely pelvic thrust here. Come on, Cloud. Pelvic thrust! that's so inappropriate. Okay, let's get on with it. Phallic much. Fortunately, this time it just takes saucy, saucy words to get Cloud to stop from murdering a companion. Oh! Blocked scene. I guess this is the only scene so far that's been blocked in the game, but I think we all know what's going on. Thank you, Square Enix, for saving the world from being spoiled. While this is going on, I'm gonna gobble up some of my oatmeal, because this crap is stone cold now. I love this scene, by the way. I don't care if it makes me a bad person, but I will go on this again. The reason why I rate Sephiroth so highly as a villain, there are a lot of little touches, and maybe I'm over-exaggerating them, maybe I'm giving them too much credit, but right after he stabs Aeris, that shit-eating grin he has, that little smirk on his face, fantastic. It's just... it's just a great touch. Alright, waiting till we're back on the delay here. I remember on the PC version, they had a problem with getting their sprites to... Oh wow, it's not going to let us go until we're out of this whole thing, is it? Alright, then I'll speed through this. Right after the death scene, when Cloud is shaking Aeris, in the PC version, there were a lot of like physics issues, and Cloud's motions would not match up to Aeris's motions. There were a lot of things that happened like that. Like the number one reactor, after you blew that up, the character sprites moving would be delayed, so the cutscene would be, or the movie would be playing in the background, and you'd be on the city screen with the reactor blowing up, and Jesse and Cloud would be running across the bottom of the screen. So, anyways, this is a tangent, remind me of that. Alright, let's get on with it. I'm going to use the wonderful magic hammer strategy. And simply put, that is... Ooh, does that reflect? Let's see if that does. I don't know if it reflects my magic hammer or not. Yeah, it does. Ah, right. Okay, I'm not going to use the magic hammer strategy because I forgot about not being able to use that. Basically, the magic hammer strategy is simply suck all the magic points out of a boss until it's incapable of fighting back. God, Tifa, you just charge these like no one's business, don't you? Oh, let's not speed this up. But you can't easily use the magic hammer strategy on this form of Genova, since she's one of the few enemies in the entire game that will actually use Reflect on you. So I'll just have to pummel her the good old-fashioned way. And yes, this is the boss mentioned earlier that deals water damage, so Barret is pretty much completely immune to all her attacks. Wow, you're just giving Tifa all the limit breaks ever. Not that she actually does any damage. Can she? She's actually dangerous in the speedrun? Oh, right. I guess they wouldn't... In a speedrun, they wouldn't have a bunch of enemy skill and whatnot. Because I'm thinking if you at least learn Magic Hammer, which would only take you a few minutes... No, you'd have to go through all the Wutai crap. Never mind. That's right. That's right. That's right. Yeah, I'm kind of hoping she does hit me with Aqua Lung. So, Tifa can learn it. I might just let her sit here and pummel us until she casts Aqua Lung. I want Tifa to get that on her enemy skill. I mean, there we go. Fantastic. Woo! Go Barret! Go Barret! Yeah! Okay, so I learned myself some Aqua Lung. Fantastic. Yeah, but if you're doing a speed run, you probably don't want to sit around for half an hour fighting one boss either. But, I mean, if you can... here I'm talking all kinds of crap. I don't even know. I forgot what materia the reflect spell is on, and if you can even cast it at the outset. Otherwise, that would undermine the whole strategy, because theoretically, you can cast reflect on yourself to counter her reflect, and then you can just magic hammer yourself, bounce it onto her, and suck out all her magic points. But then again, I don't really know anything about speedruns, so I'm sure there's a logistical reason why that's not feasible, like, you know, the fact that you'd have to go through all the Wutai crap to get Magic Hammer, and you might have to level up some materia to even cast Reflect, so... Now please, Master PlayStation, don't block the scene again. I should say Square Enix. I mean, we've played this. Everyone has played this game. No one's getting spoiled by it. It's on YouTube anyways. Don't you do it. Don't you block me. Yay! No blocking! So, I'll admit, when I was 12, 13, the first time I played this, I cried at this part of the game. I'll man up to it. I'm not really manning up, because I was a preteen / teenager, so I don't care. I'm one of those modern day men. I can let my feelings out. Also, when I was much younger, I did cry at Phantasy Star 4 when Alias got killed. I don't like cute brunette anime girls dying, I guess. Or at least I didn't. Now I've got a heart of stone, and I'm too manly for those tears. So, Cloud will state a lot of the obvious. He's a crazy crazy. And Sephiroth is using that craziness to his advantage. Which is not good, but nevertheless, Cloud is going to continue his little pursuit of vengeance, even though, logically speaking, one would deduce that he's probably incapable of actually fighting Sephiroth right now. Because if Sephiroth can just mentally dominate you and make you his puppet, then... yeah... what good are you in a fight? How do you realistically think you can actually fight him? I've actually got a story about that too, Jared. I have a sister. She's a year and a half younger than me. And I like watching other people play video games. Which is strange, because I don't like watching them do it on Twitch. You back, Rebecca? Oh, maybe she is. But I got her to play Final Fantasy VII, and I was going to pilot her through the game, right? And she made it pretty far in. She made it until the end of Disc 1. She saw what happened to Aeris, and she was just like, nope, fuck this game. This game is stupid. And she never played it again. So. She didn't take that part well. I don't think she was that invested that she cried. She wasn't a wuss like me, but she just liked the character and, yeah. Okay, so I made it as far as I really wanted to, but you know what? I did have a few short streams, and, can you tell me if my voice was cut while the gameplay was cut, or were you able to still hear me talking at least? I'm curious about that. I wasn't really paying attention to the screen, and don't know if I had audio during that time or not. If I did, it kind of sucks, but it's not that bad. But like I was saying, I've kind of had some short streams recently. I did get a lovely new piece of enemy skill materia. And for the next part, it's not going to be too hard. It's not going to be really hard at all. But I do want to grind up Tifa so she can get herself a workable bit of enemy skill materia. So I'm going to go do that now. And I will run this stream long. And who should hold it? Cloud, you can be my manipulator. And this shouldn't take too terribly long, because my characters are really strong. We already know where all this enemy skill is. And yeah, there's another bit of enemy skill later in the game, but it would be really preferable if we all had a piece. All three characters. That would be fantastic. So that is what we shall do. Even if I haven't yet decided if... Okay, I'm going to make... If I'm going to keep playing with Tifa, or if I'm going to switch to... Vincent. I kind of like the team of Tifa, Barrett, and Cloud for the upcoming section, though. Not because Tifa's a good character. She's not. Anyone pretty much will do just as good at the next point in time, but for story purposes, I like the three of them. So, I'm going to gather all the enemy skill materia I can, which should include Beta, Magic Hammer, White Wind. I guess I can get some other ones like Flamethrower, Matra Magic, Frog Song. Ooh, I could even go out of my way to get Chocobockle at this point. Do I want to waste the time with that? We'll see. My voice isn't wearing out on me yet, so... Hey, you're back! Is it super important? Alright, because I want to keep this stream going a bit longer. You can come join in on it if you want. Not that I think you do, but... I don't want to seem rude. Oh, wow. Tifa, these things are... Lightening you in the face. I can't even say that word right. You're the one who got all injured. You heal yourself. Alright, so run through all this crappy mountainous area again. I should be letting Tifa kill things. I guess I will. No, she doesn't have a... That's why I didn't do it. I was gonna say, I should be letting Tifa kill things so she can get her limits up to snuff. Actually, why don't I just switch her out with Vincent? He needs the kills more than anyone else does. Ah, you know what, it doesn't matter. It's not like I'm going to grind Vincent so he's doing perfect damage with his ultimate weapon anyway. So it's moot. It doesn't really matter. I'll keep Tifa around. I'm just too lazy to switch out. Yay, air brakes! Use them! I'll save that for another fight. God, how many encounters am I going to have to get into this place? Actually, does Destruct have the Reflect spell on it? No, maybe it's Mystify. Now I'm curious. I want to find out. Ah, Reflect is on Barrier. Okay, well, that should have been obvious. Yeah, it's a third level spell, so I guess you wouldn't really be able to do a speed run and bounce Reflect spells off of that version of Genova. Now here I am trying to find those stupid weeds again so I can get Magic Hammer on Tifa. Nope. Let's run around in circles. This time I shouldn't have anyone in the room with me complaining about the camera making them sick. Hey, look at that. The weeds showed up very quickly this time. How generous. And let's manipulate one of you. There we go. Let's get that Magic Hammer on Tifa. And Barret can use some magic points, so why not? And that'll do it for that one. So I guess we can just work our way east and get all the enemy skills along the way. Phoenix down Tranquilizer. Now Tifa has a way to replenish her magic points at will. And that will go a long way towards making some boss battles trivial. In an upcoming area. Not that they're not already easy enough, but you know what? Why not entirely neuter an enemy by sucking all their magic points away so all they can do is pop up a little bar of text. Blah 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 has no skill power left, or whatever the hell it says. Let's get out of the Wutai environs and head to the area around Gongaga. I'll pick up Frog Song next, I think. You wasting my time. Actually, you know what? There's a fine way to expedite this process. Well, is that actually going to reduce this, or is it going to bypass it? I'm curious. Let's see. Nope, it bypassed it. Did I do 1,337 damage? If so, that's a fun little coincidence there. Yeah, I know. I'm a shameless dork. Alright, let's stop off at these jungles here. So I can learn Frog Song, even though there's not much chance I'm going to end up casting it again. Ah, Tifa. Hey, there we go. We learned it. Time to end this fight. There we go. Frog Song in the bag. And next up is this continent here. Get out of there. Where I can learn Big Guard. And I don't need to learn Aqualung. Nah, I'm not gonna mess around with Magic Hammer. Hey, now she knows Big Guard. And now I should be good to go back to the environs of Junon and pick up that most essential of enemy skills, Magic Hammer. You don't have it. And I guess while I'm doing that, I might as well work my way up to near the Mithril Mines, because I'm going to have to deal with stupid Midgar Zolom and his beta again. Although that enemy skill should be fairly trivial. Oops. Hopefully he has enough magic points left to cast White Wind on me. There we go. And that takes care of that one. And now to get Flamethrower, because why not? I'm here anyways, right? They like to spawn, the fairy dragons like to spawn up in this room. Eh, not this time, apparently. Da-da. Give me my fairy dragon so I can get done with this and go deal with Zolom. Good game. How nice of you. Ah, why'd you cast that on Cloud? Now I just gotta wait here for her to target Tifa. Tifa! Ah, you stupid thing. Seriously, what is with the affection for... Okay, there's a reason she's attacking him. Does she just go after the character with the most hit points? I think it does. So, let's test that theory out. Oh, wow. You do no damage, do you, Tifa? Let's make sure Tifa has the most hit points. Yeah. It always uses that skill on the character with the... most hit points. There we go. Yeah, that's good to know. I should probably throw that in the guide, shouldn't I? Now that that's been pretty much confirmed there. Stop getting stuck on the train. What's wrong with you? There we go. Up and over. And even though Midgar Zolom isn't much of a threat anymore, I still want to make sure I'm healed up. No, Cloud, you have the most magic points, so you will get to do the honors this time. Wow, is that all you can heal? God, that spell has gotten so obsolete. And she already has the fire ring on, so that's fantastic. I should take the extra precaution just to make sure she's in the back row. Hey, Midgar Zolom, I'm ready for you. Yeah, that is neat. I'm sure somebody else knows it, but, nice to have it confirmed right there on screen. That it always uses Flame Breath on the character with the most hit points. Now I do enough damage, don't even need to opine for the days when I have Grab a Ball. There you go, kick someone out. Soften him up a little bit so he uses beta. And I should be able to just finish him off with normal attacks. There we go. That didn't take so much trouble as it did the first time, did it? So, now, if I'm not mistaken, Tifa, you should have Magic Hammer, Big Guard, White Wind, Beta. Those are pretty much all the essentials. That's fine and dandy. I'm not gonna bother to get her Mantra Magic because everything I'm gonna be fighting up in the next area is so powerful that Mantra Magic's kind of just a waste of magic points, really. At this point in the game. So I'll leave that one alone, and I will head my way back to the Forgotten City and continue on to the next area. And I will end the stream right outside the Icicle Inn, so we can get ourselves ready for a little bit of snowy fun next week. Don't go anywhere just yet. It'll probably be a little bit before I get my way over there, even at times 3 speed. A few random encounters to go through, treasure to loot, weird glowy caves with conveniently spaced crevices to explore, and all that fun stuff. I should also note that if you really, really want to score Omni Slash, this actually isn't a terrible time in the game to do it. I'm not sure off the top of my head if the prices at the Gold Saucer have gone down yet, but you do have the ribbon accessory, which Which means you should be able to weather the... Stop getting stuck on the train. The random effects of the wheels after each battle, not to mention the crap the enemies will try to inflict upon you during the fight. Oops. I always go that wrong way. So if you want Cloud's Omni Slash, it's not impossible to get it at this point in time. You'll probably have more difficulty, more tedious, more expensive, I should say, to get the gold pieces you'll need to participate in the arena fights. And since it just becomes so much easier later on in the game, that's when I'll wait to do it all. I don't see any real bother of getting death sentence right here, so I'm just going to speed on through this. Have taken a beating and wasted a lot of magic points, so why not use these crusty old beds? Ah, does it? And does it say that it always uses it on the character with the most hit points? Oh, crap! I did not know those things had that enemy skill. Awesome! I didn't have to go out of my way to learn enemy or level 4. Whatever, Barret, you can die all you want. I'll bring him back to life. So, that was fortuitous there. Had all my party learn level 4 suicide, which if you have a level that is a multiple of 4 and an enemy hits you with that, it will reduce your hit points to a fraction of normal and inflict the mini small whatever status it is. That's not where I wanted to go. I better turn off times 3 speed or I'm never going to be able to get up this ramp. There we go. There we go. Let's go around. Yay! Another weapon for Sid. Okay, well that's good to know. I never really messed around with outside sources for my guide, so... I mean, there are some things I remember looking up a long time ago, like there's essentially a way to auto-kill enemies if you do so much damage that it sets their hit points to... Or that you do so much damage that it goes over the maximum damage the game will recognize. But I've never messed around. I've heard about it, I've read about it, but I never really messed around with any of that. And let's follow this fortunate seashell into these caves. There's so much weird terrain that... Oh, please eat Barret. Please eat Barret. Oh, that'd be fantastic. Yes! Oh, that's so creepy. I love when they do that. Just ignore me. I don't know why I find that so funny. I've been wanting an enemy to eat one of my characters for a while now. Oh, right. I can't go that way. Well, let's go left, and this is the whole nature of these caves, where you have to know your rights and lefts, which I rarely do. Okay, there we go. Bolt armlet, actually a pretty good little item to wear. It's kind of light on the materia sockets, but I kind of have a lot of junk equipped anyway, so I'm not too worried about that. Hey, where'd your enemy skill go? There we go. Now Tifa is immune to lightning, which is always nice. Anyways, like I was saying, so much navigation in this game is predicated on there just being a temporary little bit of, like, a shell or some debris ledge. You know, it almost feels like if you came back to this world 10 days later, it would be entirely impassable. I don't know. Kind of bothers me. Like, if it's a cutscene and you're running away across, like, a crumbling bridge, that's one thing, but if that's like the static dungeon design, I find that a little weird. I don't know. No, I'm just nitpicking. You're wrong. So, I should equip that materia I just got. I just got some magic plus materia, which I poo-pooed the idea of. Actually, I want to keep that on me, because there's going to be an enemy I want to manipulate, and it would suck to not have that. I poo-pooed the idea of leveling up your, or grinding for magic sources. That's just because the enemy is so tedious, you would be there for weeks grinding that thing. And I don't really feel it's worth it. Now, magic is a good stat, especially when you're pummeling things with Knights of the Round and whatnot. But it's not good enough that I'm going to sit there and spend that much time grinding up magic sources. A good substitute for that, however, is magic plus materia, which when it's fully upgraded will increase your magic score by 50%. For a long period of time in the game, that's not going to be, it's not going to be paying off very good dividends, but at the end, when you can level everything up and, you know, you have master materia, so all your materia is like condensed into three sockets plus some support and command materia. You have plenty of empty space to throw in whatever you want. So if you want to boost a character's magic for that, that's a viable way of doing it. You probably won't be maxing out at 255, but even that bonus 50% will help with the damage a bit. So, there we go. That'll end the stream for today. I am outside of the Icicle Inn. Disc 1 is done. Eris is dead. Boo-hoo. Everyone's sad. I will catch you all next week. This has been Haeravon of Gamer Guides. If you like this stream, we will be streaming more on Wednesdays and Fridays. I don't think we figured out what Claire is streaming next. I think the choices were between The Witcher 3 and Metal Gear Solid 5. But if she doesn't hold to that, don't be too disappointed. We don't know what she's going to be doing yet on Wednesday, but Jared will be streaming God of War 3, hopefully wrapping up that game. And of course, if you like our streams, our playing, hey, maybe you'll like our guides. Go check those out at www.gamerguides.com. You can also buy our guides on iTunes and the Google Play Store. And that's enough shilling. I will see you guys next week. Take care.